Seems like every year the season starts a little earlier. Last year was an exception. Last year we started late because of how cold it was, but we're pretty much on track. It's this time of the year where it's above freezing during the day and below freezing at night, and that's when the trees push sap. And so not only do you have like the sugar maples and the silver maples that you can tap, but also sycamores and black walnuts can be tapped. You can't get as much sugar out of them. It takes a lot more gallons to boil down. I think maple syrup, something like 55 gallons boils down of sap, boils down to 1 gallon of maple sugar. And I think that the black walnut and the sycamore take like 80 to 100 gallons. We usually do a combination of trees to set us apart from the maple syrup producers in the area and do an estate syrup. We have a partnership with Funk's Grove Maple Syrup, so we're not tapping this year, especially with the infrastructure projects we have going on, and we do like partnering with the other local producers, and so we'll be getting everything for our brunch from them. We buy an entire year's supply from them before they sell out, because they sell out early, and they've expanded their production, and so it's a great tourist destination to go and check out. The vineyard's doing pretty well. We have a lot of things going on. We're gonna be planting some replacement plants as well as taking out the co-rot noir that's on an acre of it. There's not much left. Doesn't do well in this region, we found out. Fungal issues, winter issues, what we call crown gall issues. We'll be putting in some Cab Franc and then replacing some Norton. That's gonna be exciting. We got a prune, so we'll be pruning in the next couple of weeks. Jacob's grabbing the eggs from the eggmobiles. In front of the vineyard, we're gonna do a polyculture of plantings of everything that likes to grow on trellis. We have some grapes on that, we have some wild grapes on it, and then we're gonna be planting Asian pears, some apples, hardy kiwi, and a few other crops, as well as herbaceous plants that will be able to go into the wine. We wanna be able to plant more crops that could help us not only do just a regular table wine, but also a vermouth. Next to the vineyard is a couple hundred elderberry plants, and we grow a lot of elderberries. We have a lot of elderberries on the old farm, and this year we'll be doing a lot of cuttings. They're easy to propagate, and we'll be planting those in areas of the farm that are a little bit wetter. They like to have wet feet, not too wet, but they do like a lot of water. And that's a really staple medicinal crop for us, as well as something we can include in recipes and sauces. Right in front of the elderberries, we have some mixed berries, and then we have 900 hazelnut trees. And those hazelnut trees, Mark Shepard, who is one of the great, amazing ambassadors of regenerative agriculture, he just came out with, I think it's his second or third book that was just released. I think it's called Water for Every Farm. It's an amazing book. I just got it. I'm excited to get into it a little bit more. But we got all of that rootstock one-year saplings from him 2 years ago. They're established. We've had about 95, 96% success rate. And so those are gonna be entering their third season. So, with perennials, most perennials, it's like year one, they just sit there, especially those were planted late in the season. They just kind of sit. Year two, they creep. Year three, they leap. Year four, they explode. If you get them in really early, you can bring it back a year and they'll explode on year three. So I'm hoping we can see some explosion, because they're still kind of like creeping right now. So hopefully this will be a nice growing season where we can get some solid growth from them. In front of the hazelnuts, we get into the garden sites and a lot of the contour. We're gonna be putting in a 2 acre fruit orchard, lots of mixed crops, mostly stone fruits, apples, pears, quince, plums, not only the European but also Asian plums, peaches, lots of peaches, persimmons, apricots, cherries, all types of cherries, as well as some Korean bush cherries that I'm really excited to plant and have up here for not only landscaping but also an edible landscape, which is really key to integrate the landscape and the food, so when guests are here and they're enjoying the ceremony of a wedding, they can kind of experience where the food is coming from and see it firsthand. We try to be as diverse as possible to be more resilient, but also to extend our season. We want stone fruits early and we want them late. We even have a greenhouse that we're gonna be putting stone fruits and berries in, because we wanna be able to have them early and late compared to the outside. Just, it's a shorter season when it's outdoors. When it's indoors, it's a much longer season, which is really nice. And then we got the gardens. There's now 10 acres of garden beds cut in. that are all established. We have 1 acre still to till in, to turn over this spring. And then that'll be rolling. We don't have much going this winter. We have 1 acre of wheat. It's a wheat that I started with a pack of seeds, you know, in the palm of my hand. And it's just taken 4 years to build up seed to where we have it now at 1 acre plot that gets harvested with a 1956 72 inch head all crop combine. So we actually have a restored combine to be able to harvest that. And then where the wheat was last year, I'm not 100% sure if this rotation is going to be ideal. I think it's going to be, but where the wheat was last year is now where the garlic is. And so we have 1 acre of garlic planted that's under hay mulch. I checked on it when I just got back and it looks really good. There's a really nice root ball. It's well insulated, good coverage. I'm excited to see our garlic crop this year because it's every year it gets just better and better and better. This should be a breakthrough year for us, and you know we're going to be planning more trips to the farm and more agrotourism than ever, and we're hoping to do more weddings than ever, and also fundraisers. This has become a really ideal place to do fundraising for non-for-profits that have similar goals and mindsets when it comes to regenerative ag and community. It's a lifetime of planning and design work that's going to be here, but the next 5 years are going to be really important for us and critical in the way that we design and lay out these plantings. You know, we're planting trees that they're not even planned to be harvested or utilized for 20 to 30, 40 years. And so, you know, this isn't really about now. It's really about planning and building something for later. You know, it's a mixed thing. You can only do so much. You got to think about the cash crops that we need for this season to survive and to make payroll and pay for cost of goods. But then you also need to be playing downfield and think about, okay, where do we want to be, you know, 10, 15, 30, 40 years from now? And we really want to be a shining example for great stewardship. It's going to be a good year. I'm really, really excited with what's going on. Team's strong. And we got a lot of momentum.